of photos.
This was happening in New Delhi?
No, in Srinagar.
In Srinagar.
And in those days, there was another very, very famous man, so famous that I've forgotten his name. Gopikrishna. Gopikrishna was a man, he was working for the railways, national railways in India. And he was not satisfied with his life, so he was reading books. And one day he found a practical exercise that he liked. The exercise was to concentrate on the top of his head for 3 hours. So he did it. He did it for I don't know how long, several years, every morning, early morning. In India, people wake up very early. So he did it. And one day, after several years, so he was also living in Srinagar. So one day, after several years, one morning, he felt something tickling on his perineum. So mentally he went down and the thing stopped. So it came back to the top of his head and started again. Came down again, stopped. So 2 or 3 or 4 times. And then he said, well, next time it tickles, I will not go down, I will stay here. So he did. And a terrible thing happened to him. An incredible force passed through him and completely, as he said, destroyed his brain. And he went crazy for about 20 years. And he went through terrible sufferings, terrible experiences. It was really terrible. And he didn't know what to do. And he went to Lakshmanjuna. In fact, he went to meeting many, many yogis because his life was terrible. He has written a book about this. And he went to see Lakshmanjuna. He also went to see, in these days, what's his name? Sri Aurobindo. And everyone says, sorry, I can't do anything. The energy has awakened. You have practiced too strongly without any indications, and you hurt yourself, and you only have 2 has to do. But in India, they call energy, I told you in the beginning, they call it the goddess. So they just ask the goddess. And he went to Sri Aurobindo, and Sri Aurobindo said, I'm sorry, I can't do anything. So it went on for years, and one day he did a kind of inner gymnastic, and he changed the thing, and the suffering went away, and it took 20 years. So after that, one day he went and met again Lakshmanjuna. And I visited a few times Gopikrishna. And first time I went to him, he was a very simple man, sitting in the sun. When I met him, he was hot, just in the sun. Kashmir is cold in winter, and it was in winter, it's snowy. Just in the sun, on the terrace, and taking the sun rays. And I asked him about this meeting. Say, what happened the second time we met Lakshmanjuna? Oh, he said, we just look each other in our eyes and we just start laughing. That's all. So, there are some kind of individuals. The life, their life seems to be a testimony of what I've tried to talk about. And it's really beyond the understanding. You really do not understand what goes on. You know, you go and see the biggest guru of Kashmir Shivaism, and what you do is just having tea and looking at family photos. And until you say, well, I'm fed up, you say, what? Like, this is the teaching, you know, you have to be there all the time. Oh. And then, in fact, it was, unless you are more present than more absent, unless that teaching formal things is totally useless, because you will not understand anything, and I will lose my time. So I like to watch my family photos. If you don't like, the door is open.
The door of the library is open.
And I remember one day I said, okay, I'm going. I said, okay. Fine, have a nice evening. I'll come back tomorrow. Take me ready. And I remember another yogi who was also a Shivaite. Now we are into gossiping. Little personal stories. I loved him. First time I saw him, I loved him. He was such a beautiful man. And I stopped and I started talking with him, and he was speaking perfect English. And I came to know through his disciples that he was from a Maharaja family. And he has left the family. But he has such, you say, prestance. And his English was bluff, very flower language, very beautiful. And I don't know why he mistook me. He thought that I had lived with him in a cave some years before. Because at that time I was, you know, when you stay in India, your skin became darker and my hair was very black, and so. And I was also wearing the orange robe. And I didn't understand at first. So we became friends. He thought we were friends. We were together in the same cave some years ago. And after some time, I understood that he was taking me for someone else. So I told him, I said, well, you know, I'm not this one. Oh, he said, doesn't matter. Anyway, we love much each other, so it's okay. Past doesn't matter. And I said, yes, I agree, but we stayed whole day long together. And after I don't know how long, I told him, I said, I would like you to teach me something. So he said, we don't teach to friends, you know, we are brothers, what shall I teach you? So I insisted. And then he said, okay, come back tomorrow. So the next day I went again, chit-chat for hours and hours. I said, oh, you remember? I said, oh, yes, well, come back tomorrow. And it went on for a long time. Every day I'd come back tomorrow. Until one day I had to go precisely to Kashmir, to Srinagar. So I went to him and I said, Brother Ji, I'm leaving tomorrow, I'm going to Kashmir. Oh, he said, bad luck, we're going to start tomorrow. But I have my ticket and I left. We met again several times now.
How was when you lose your regrets?
When I lose my regrets? I regret, I don't remember. I think regretting is something that comes and goes. Now, if it becomes obsessional, this is where it is difficult. But I think that I've been saved from obsessions. But come tomorrow. We'll see. Maybe it's time for dinner, no?
So another question, if you have the last one.
Oh, that was the last one.
I'm sure.
Okay. So what can I say that there is another, the last one?
This course I have lots of questions, but I don't think I will ask all of them now.
Oh, so thanks.
Until January, when the course starts, will you be available in Romania, or are you coming back only in January?
I'm here until next Monday.
Okay.
But we're going traveling for a few days. Well, let's see if we go traveling. I think we do. And there is an evening which might be organized in Bucharest, either Saturday or Sunday, which will be OISGON, the Indian Romanian, which will be a mantra evening.
Okay.
And this is organized by George Petra.
Okay.
Oh, you know him? So you just phone him.
Okay.
We have to talk about it tomorrow. Don't know if it will be Saturday or Sunday.
Next week.
Yeah, next week. Today's Monday.
Yes. So basically to synthesize most of the questions into one, what is the relationship between this teaching and the more formal Indian teaching like Vedanta and the whole, I mean, not in the philosophical sense, but in the sense of to use the language of the Vedic teaching. For example, you only mentioned two of the three gunas. The knowledge aspect, the intellectual aspect, is relevant or not in this? This is one point. And the other point, if this is too sophisticated for now, it's okay. And the other point is there any real connection between the Vijnana Bhairava as a tantric text from the school you come from the not school, from the line you come from, and the Bhairava of the of Varanasi, of Kashi, the Bhairava Shankaracharya? Is it the same thing or not?
So, first thing, the common point is very simple. Common point is shifting from duality to non-duality. Whatever lineage, whatever the teachings are, the common point is always this. Shifting from duality to non-duality, which means shifting from conflict to peace. That's another way.
But that can be done through conflict also.
To say it. We are starting from duality because we only know this. So duality means conflict. So we are starting from that because that's the only thing we know. We don't know what is state of unity, we don't know what is non-violence, we don't know what is peace, we don't know what is joy, we don't know. These are just words. So we are starting from our reality and trying to shift to that state of non-duality. That is, we are trying to not to acquire anything, but to expel everything which is an obstacle to perceiving that state of unity. Because, you know, if unity exists, it exists. Either you feel it or not, doesn't matter. If unity exists, it is not somewhere else. If it was somewhere else, then it would be duality. It is not tomorrow. If it was tomorrow, there would be duality. You understand? So that exists anyway. And what he said is that it is the only reality. All the rest is a wrong perception. We don't say it's illusion. Illusion, it doesn't belong to this the vocabulary doesn't belong to those traditions. We never say it's illusion. We say it's a wrong perception. And so all the, we call it the sadhana, here we say the practice. So the sadhana is shifting from duality to non-duality.
But the method. Sorry.
The method.
Are the methods prescribed by other traditions but using the same symbols?
No.
Producing the same.
Yeah, well, this is a big problem we have regarding the Indian culture. Because in India, they're using the same words in different languages for explaining things which are different. And it's a big, big difficulty today, especially in the West, because many, many writers, for example, they